My mic was muted, I didn't know. Hey! This is the worst intro I've ever done, Jesus Christ. You know those, like, YouTube videos and comments and stuff where they say a game is underrated or a hidden gem, and then they talk about, like, Titanfall 2 or something that's actually fairly well known, it just didn't sell great? Click here to find out about this super secret video game you've never heard of, and you click and it's like, L.A. Noire. With most games, even like the super unheard of, completely niche stuff, I've at least heard someone say something about it. Like, even if it's in passing mention, I've heard something about it. Unless it's maybe like a Japanese Sega Saturn FMV game or something, I guess. But here, I only play real fucking video games, and so today, I found a game that until now, I just assumed I made up or something. The Saboteur is a game that I played when I was like 11, liked, and then never heard anything about. Not even a comment mentioning it or anything. It has been seemingly forgotten by absolutely everyone, and I don't really know why. And so if I can have just one person see this game, think, that's cool, and never play it, well, that's enough for me. The game was developed by Pandemic, who actually made Battlefront and Destroy All Humans. This was even their final game before closing down due to bankruptcy. Their last two games are almost fitting, feeling like final steps for their series. The other final game was Lord of the Rings Conquest, which is very similar to Battlefront, while this connects itself to Destroy All Humans and Mercenaries by being an open world title about destruction. I feel like I'm going too fast here though. The game has you playing as Sean Devlin, an Irish race car driver in World War II, and the game starts with... It starts with him moping in a bar, and then you blow up like one thing, and then the game goes back a couple months, but I feel like that's dumb. Like, structurally, I just don't like it. The starting part acts as a tutorial, but it only lasts like 5 minutes, and what they tell you isn't relevant until after the flashback stuff. It's disorientating and unnecessary, and the story never jumps about chronologically like this again. I know it's supposed to be a hook to have you keep playing, but this prologue isn't exactly slow. I'd even say these 5 minutes feel slower paced than the prologue, so I don't know. I'm saying the game starts where the story chronologically starts, and you can't stop me. Anyway, this prologue has you competing in a race against Nazis before one of them cheats, wins the race, and you decide to destroy his car for a form of revenge. Writing-wise, this starting bit is probably my favourite part of the game. It's silly and basic, but it feels right. The heroes are shown as charismatic and brave underdogs, while the Nazis are shown as heartless and over-serious. It's nothing amazing or even really notably good, but it fits. It feels like it could be taken from some old World War II themed comic. But then the Nazi finds out you destroyed his car, and the tone jumps completely. Sean's friend Jules is killed in torture, and it feels almost harrowing, with his cries for help implying he's been blinded. From here though, the tone never recovers. The game decides after this that it's a darker look at the horrors of war, which is bizarre, since we were just up against Nazi race car drivers, but that's how the game is now. Except it never really feels that way. There's a couple moments where characters' dialogue comes off as anti-war, but then it disappears again completely. The ending too is fairly dark, with the line, "Are we both going to hell?" getting dropped, but these are the only couple moments I remember that embraced a darker tone. The rest just comes together as a sludge of completely unmemorable writing. It also doesn't really work since everyone still feels like they're from that World War II themed comic the start resembled. These are still really silly cartoon characters, it's just that they have opinions on war. It kind of reminds me of Wolfenstein The New Order, but that game works because characters feel so grounded. Blazkowicz is this perfect action hero, but the dialogue he gives feels so grounded and personal that he ends up feeling real, and I can't say the same for Sean, who just kind of makes jokes and is horny. Also, I just don't agree with the final message, like, at all. The game has two moral stances, it has the Nazis, who are comically evil, and it has the Resistance, who are trying to stop them, but it tries to act like both sides are morally questionable because due to the Resistance, civilians start standing up to the Nazis and some of them will get hurt. which is just a bizarre message. Do not stand up to blatant oppression because someone else might do the same and get hurt by the oppressors is just fucking stupid. And it blames the resistance for the actions they're resisting. This isn't to say you can't have morally grey stories about warfare. Most World War I stories are that, but doing it in this way where one side is cartoonishly evil, you have to blame the people on the right, which just doesn't work for me. If it works for you, then... Ah.
Oh no.
Yeah, exactly, oh no. The story can feel pretty loose, and when it actually tries stuff, it's pretty bad, but there's still good stuff here. You get to blow things up, and sneak at the same time, that's cool. As I mentioned, this is a destruction-based open world game. You go about liberating Paris through missions that often have you blowing something up. There's a bunch of games like this, but what differentiates The Saboteur is that it has much more of a stealth focus. There are side missions where you have to destroy a Nazi base, but you don't shoot 15 rockets at some factory and fly away. Instead, you plant the bomb, hoping no one sees you, and then run off into Paris. It feels a lot more grounded. You can actually use disguises. If you kill an enemy in hand-to-hand combat or through a takedown, you can sneak about like Hitman by taking their... And I mean, yeah, it is Hitman, but I guess in Hitman you're wanting to avoid anyone seeing your crime, and in this people will know something happened because... But you don't want them to know it was you, so you just kinda go like, oh no, someone blew up the sniper tower? There are open world stealth games obviously, but they generally use basic line of sight stealth. But here, you'll probably be out in the open, just trying to keep far away enough to not be detected. Also, unlike lots of open world games, killing enemies isn't really encouraged. Melee stuff takes a while, and you don't have an endless supply of gadgets to fit into every situation. It's surprisingly limited with how many gadgets you get. There's a silenced pistol and a silenced SMG, but these require their own silenced ammo and will take up one of your two weapon slots. So if you're caught with the pistol, you'll only have one weapon you'll want to use, since the silenced pistol is so weak. The silenced SMG does break the game a little bit. I could be seen by everyone, but only one person can activate the alarm at a time. So I'd just kill them, and someone else would try to activate it, but I'd kill them. And it just ended up in this loop where no one was allowed to shoot me because the alarm wasn't activated, but no one could activate the alarm because of my gamer skills. The SMG doesn't unlock until near the end of the game though, and ammo for it costs a lot, so it doesn't ruin the game. This kind of stealth takes up a good chunk of the demolition stuff, but in the open world you also have plenty of random destructible targets you can destroy for money, and disguises aren't as useful for these. Instead, you just leap from building to building using free running, similar to Assassin's Creed, but honestly, kind of more fun. Assassin's Creed can feel very automatic. A lot of it is just finding the path you want to run. The game won't let you fall often, and if you do, you probably won't die. The Saboteur has no kind of safety net though, and feels a lot more exciting as a result. There are ziplines you can hang on to fling yourself from building to building, but grabbing onto them without stopping has you just leaping into the air, hoping you won't plummet to the ground. It's really basic, but really fun given the setting. Paris is just a cool place to run around, and buildings aren't so tall that climbing them is annoying, but still give you that needed sense of scale. So time spent just fucking about in the open world has you finding destructible environments, planting a bomb and dashing off before it attracts Nazis or the debris gets in your way. It's basic, and I could not clear all these objectives, but simply taking Assassin's Creed's safety net away makes running around this city feel exciting. In fact, the city itself is actually kind of exciting and fun as well. I've been to Paris in real life twice, and don't really remember how it looked because I was quite young, but I remembered how this game looked, and that's really sad. It manages to capture the feel of Art Deco posters through its warmish, kind of yellowy colour scheme, and it feels pretty big while not actually being too big, so traversal isn't annoying. There's not even a fast travel function, but that's never annoying, and the game still feels expansive. It even has a countryside area, which is great. I love when you get to go to the outskirts area in an open world game. It feels like you're going on holiday. But what stands out especially is how the game plays with the time period through presentation. When you get in a car, the radio sounds kind of tinny and rubbish, like an old radio, but then fades into a higher quality and it feels very grand and exciting. It also helps that the music's pretty good. Please don't make fun of me for that, complimenting 40s music is really embarrassing and I'm sticking my neck out here. The main thing with presentation though is that areas you haven't captured in the game are black and white. Or actually it's more like Sin City, with red still being shown to make Nazi stuff clear, along with blue still being shown and having the resistance wear an item of blue to make them stand out. I really like this idea, it stops areas from blending together and unlike a lot of other open world games, it makes it immediately clear whether you've claimed an area. Being in heavily Nazi controlled areas feels like you're not supposed to be there and has a kind of daunting atmosphere, and that's really cool. I especially love the catacombs, where everything is black and white apart from the fires illuminating it, it looks really cool. I was a bit concerned at first because the game doesn't communicate how these areas are claimed very well, and I thought you had to destroy all the Nazi stuff in an area to claim it, and that just sounded awful. But no, you just do missions and the areas are claimed. Not just main missions either, you have to do the side missions as well, which... sure. The game has a really good, unique atmosphere and identity that I really appreciate. It doesn't just feel like a World War II game and it doesn't just feel like Paris, it feels like you're in Paris as of World War II. The rest of the presentation though is where the game falls a bit. I mentioned that this was Pandemic's last game before they went bankrupt and it kind of feels that way. It's buggy and isn't held together very well. For one, the audio mixing is completely fucked. Full volume in the regular game is way too loud, but if you make that sound normal, then the cutscenes are barely audible. Closing the game through the game crashes it every time, and unless you have two monitors, you can't close it via Task Manager. Even if you do have two monitors, it's easier to just close the game through Task Manager while it's running. Buildings would sometimes kind of disappear? I don't know what to call this. The end of the game is supposed to have the city in chaos where everyone's fighting but it's just... quiet. Postal 2 did this better. Also at the end of the game you have this race, but they spawn the drivers in as you progress in the race, so you don't do too well I guess, but it's really easy, so you overtake everyone who spawned and then just sit in 10th place for ages. Here's just a bunch of glitches in general. A lot of elements feel very janky too. The combat is fine, but it's way too easy on anything but the highest difficulty, and even then it's not that hard since the AI is really weird. If they have cover, they will stay in cover, they will never push you, so you can just sit and slowly pick them off from cover with no issue. The only times it was actually challenging was when the enemies weren't given cover. Also, game feel for combat is all over the place. SMGs and stuff feel pretty good, but all the shotguns are really weak feeling. The game has a neat auto cover system where you duck naturally next to cover, but enemies still hit you sometimes even if you're in cover. The wanted system feels a bit janky too. It's a bar that fills when you're seen committing crimes, and when it fills you count as detected. But certain things that blatantly are crimes won't get you detected, like running over pedestrians or Nazi stuff feels illegal, but you're not armed and you're not planting a bomb, so it's fine. And the game overall just feels a bit off. There's a mission where you have to assassinate some woman, so the Nazis kind of teleported around. She started singing silently while the Nazis stood watching like it's a machinima, and then I sniped her. Like, it's supposed to be this morally conflicting objective, but it's so weirdly presented. You kind of get it, right? It's a bit of a mess and the story feels terribly written. You're probably thinking, this sounds like a generally unappealing game and it makes sense that it's been lost to time. And you know what? Fuck off. I still like this game. It's good. I had fun going through it. That platforming stuff, the social stealth stuff, and the overall style were enough to make me enjoy it. It's got a lot of issues. A lot of issues. Oh, but I don't think it deserves to be forgotten in the way it has been, and also I don't think it's been forgotten due to the actual game. That's a big part of it obviously, but it's also not on Steam. It's got a weird thing where it's on GOG and Origin, but the GOG version is pretty expensive and the Origin version doesn't have the patches that the GOG version does. No one's gonna buy the game on PC through the methods available without already knowing what it is, and it's not very well known, so it's just gonna be less and less known as time goes on. If it's on sale on GOG, I'd try it though, it is good. Even on Origin, you can apply those GOG patches, and I'm sure it works without the patches anyway. It'd be nice to have it put on Steam just so it's more accessible and more people see it, but I don't really think there's much of a interest from any kind of community or anything for it being put on Steam. But at the same time, EA do seem to be putting just more stuff on Steam just now, so I don't know, maybe it may happen. Only time can tell. For the meantime, it's pretty good. Not amazing, but like, I don't know, it's worth remembering. Anyway, that's all I really wanted to say. It feels weird to talk about a game that's not like especially interesting or anything, and it's just kind of alright. Like, it's pretty good and I give it a try. Yeah, that's it really. My next video is actually on a sequel to a game I've already talked about, so try and guess what it is. I'm gonna end the video now before you realize that I don't know how to end videos.
I don't think I'll ever live to see a prophet. I don't want to be a locket clinging to a chest till the last breath.